Hello and welcome to the Reasons I'm Broke podcast, bringing you the reasons we're broke, ranging from comics, movies, TV, video games, and more. I'm Daniel.
And I'm Kelli.
For any new brokeheads out there, the way we format the show is first we cover some news ranging from comics, movies, TV, video games, and more, and then we top it off with some comic book highlights for the week.
But before we get into that news, we do want to share a story of the week. Dan has a great one for us.
I'm happy to announce that they have released the Daniel from the Reasons I'm Broke pop figurine.
I'm sure that's what it is.
If you go to stores, I mean, they put the Batman v Superman logo on there because that's the next movie I'm going to watch in theaters.
Okay.
So they wanted to keep it current.
Yeah.
And then they released it with my little pop. It's got my long hair, my beard, and it's got the tattoos on there.
Mm-hmm.
But because of copyright reasons, I didn't sign off on this. They have to extend the tattoos from the arm over to the chest and kind of change them a little bit.
Yeah.
They didn't have Bruce Timm's permission to put the animated series on the right arm.
Mm-hmm.
And then they labeled it with Aquaman because they remembered that funny story you told last week with the Ocean Master, and that relates to Aquaman.
I'm sure it's not just the Jason Momoa Aquaman pop figurine.
No, Jason Momoa is like so much bigger and muscly than what this little pop does. They saw the Twitter picture that we put up last year of me as Aquaman, and they said, oh shit, this guy looks amazing even without the Aquaman stuff. Why don't we make a pop out of him? And he likes Batman and DC so much, we'll put him in the same line as Batman and Wonder Woman and all the rest of them. So you can now order your own Daniel from the Reasons I'm Broke pop, and if you want, you can send it on over. I'll sign it for you. Not a problem. Not a big deal. I'll take time out of my day. I'll sign these things.
It's not really you, Danny.
Look, I'm just happy that they finally got a superhero out there that I can somewhat relate to and say that right there looks the closest to me at the moment. I know Aquaman purists are freaking out and saying that's not Aquaman, and when Batman v Superman releases this month, people are gonna think that that is the Aquaman from the comics, and it's not. And I'm thinking, well, what I'm happy about this in general, because this is a cooler looking Aquaman. Like, say what you will about the classic Aquaman if it holds a special place in your heart, but this is going to appeal to the mass audiences. And that's what these movies do, is they appeal to everyone because that's where the dollar is. And if this creates tons of Aquaman fans, so be it, because that character needs the help. And if they put him as is in the movies, do you think he'd be as popular?
Well, I mean, not for you, because you finally have, like, a brown superhero.
Well, when that first picture came out, there was such a positive reaction to this Aquaman, aside from the Aquaman fans. Everyone else was like, finally, Aquaman looks badass and looks cool, because let's face it, he was kind of a joke before that.
You mean he was kind of really white before that? There's no sun down in the ocean. He can't be that tan.
He comes up. Do you think he just stays down there all day?
Well, I mean, pretty much. What's he going to come up for?
Plus, they're Atlanteans. Who's to say their DNA isn't different? That even that little a bit of sun makes them a little bit tanner? They're not humans.
Like, he goes out in the sun, it's like, he just morphs into the super tan man.
The super tan man.
His tan lines must be horrible if that happens.
Like, before this pop released, Snape was the closest pop figurine out there that looked like me, just because of the hair. I didn't even have a beard. And then the Aquaman pop, I saw it in previews. I'm like, holy shit, finally, I can relate to one of the characters. Like, white people everywhere, they have all, like, an endless amount of characters that they can pick from. Redheads, even, there's a ton of them out there. African Americans have more out there. And now I'm like, here we go. Finally, there's one.
Someone for me to cosplay as. I still think for MegaCon, you should go dressed as your Jason Momoa Aquaman that we made you with your fork trident.
I'm going to post that picture up again just in case Broketz missed it. But I bought that as soon as it came in. I'm like, oh, that is mine right there.
That
represents me. I don't who know, maybe Aquaman isn't even cool in the movie, but it's still like, this is, I can relate to this pop.
Well, I'm glad that was the highlight of your week.
That was a good thing. Now, a non-highlight of the week, and you work with cash handling and credit cards,
of
although
course.
Yours might be different.
Yes.
But me having working in retail now, credit cards are moving over to the chip. If your bank hasn't sent you an updated card yet, they have a little chip reader, or actually just a chip on the credit card, and a lot of retailers are moving over to the chip reader, which is a more secure form of doing transactions. People may be rolling their eyes right now. do you understand how it works? Is basically it immediately sends that information over to the bank. So if someone with your credit card number or a chip similar to yours or a copy chip makes a transaction over in Arkansas and you live in Florida, 5 minutes from now, they can immediately track it down and shut it down. It's a quicker transmission of information than what the magnetic strip did.
Right.
So it's a security thing. But the endless amount of whining that I hear over this chip because it's simply different and you're not used to tells me how much of a first world problem having a chip on a credit card is. Oh, it's so annoying because back when they had the carbon copy credit card machines, those existed. People got used to them. Switched over to magnetic strip. People bitched about that. They got used to them. Chip is the exact same thing. Takes the same amount of time, if not less. And it's just because you're not used to putting the chip into the credit card machines because not every retailer or major box store has these yet. And that's why they're complaining about it. So whenever I hear like, these chips, I'm immediately like, how easy do we have it in this country where chips on a little credit card, a little minor inconvenience to some because they're not used to it, is a hardship in this world.
I remember before even credit cards were big, my mom would be writing checks everywhere we go. Like, we used to go to Dillard's, and she would write out a check for whatever we purchased.
Checks, you needed the credit, you needed the actual check, you needed a driver's license, they needed to input all those numbers, they needed to do a check on those.
And then they had to put them in a little printer, and it went like...
Those were, in comparison, hardships. Although even that, it's like, fucking take 60 seconds, calm the fuck down.
Yeah.
So it's, to see... The chip things, it's, and a lot of them is older people. It's like, you remember when it was the carbon copy credit card machines. Like, young kids I never hear them complain about the chip, but it's just older people that whine about it that I can't stand.
Well, even like I hear people complain, because I don't work with the chip in my location, but I work with like Apple Pay a lot or Google Wallet, and they complain that our readers don't always read their credit card the first time. I'm like, you realize that your money's on your phone, your $700 phone that can connect to the internet at any point. Like, you don't even need to carry anything but your phone.
And it sends a wireless signal, like magic, like through outer the air.
Space.
And then back to the credit card machine.
Yes, and then you had to touch it twice. It's sending a wireless signal to the device to take your money. And how...
Oh, but it takes so long. It took like 20 seconds.
Ugh, why won't this read? Why? Ugh, just forget about it. Here,
I hate that it tells me the chip.
It's crazy. And then I have a friend who has it. Then you can put multiple credit cards on there. So you just scroll to pick which credit card you want.
But I have to use my finger on the screen.
This it's like, touch screen. This color touchscreen.
High definition touchscreen, and soon it's going to be 4K touchscreens. It's going to be
it'll be holograms. I have to switch over from my videos that I'm watching.
It's not reading which, in the future, that's what it's going to be. It's not reading which way my eye is moving to scroll. It's just not getting the signal from my mind to just give a thought to charge this thing. I can't believe it. Like, if I were to exist 200 years from now, I'm like, what are you guys fucking bitching about? You have a telephone. Your telephone is in your mind, and you can just mind it over to that mind.
Just
and
mind
just,
it.
Just send credits over to that thing, and then you pay for it from your home, and then they teleport
or even
the
like,
item to your
money
house.
Money doesn't even exist. We're just trading humans now.
Holy shit.
That's what happened in our future.
We went backwards. We don't trade humans anymore, Kelly. That's well, at least not in this country. I don't know.
History always repeats itself.
That's what they say. That's such. I always hated that when my history teacher would say that history repeats itself. Well, not always. I know what he's saying in that countries eventually a generation dies, new generation takes over and doesn't learn necessarily from previous generations, which is why history is so important because you gotta take that and reflect on it, but. To say that we're going to go back to, like, pyramids or something like that is
nonsense.
Oh,
we'll see. Is this a bet?
If this is a bet, there won't be microphones to be gloating on in that time period.
That's fine. I'll still win. I'll know from my grave, like, I hope somebody finds this podcast 200 years from now. When you have your mind phone, please mind me to the grave. send me the information and be like, Kelli, you won. And then from my death, I'll be like, yes, I won that bet.
This is why, like, 80 episodes ago, I was all like, hey, robots, you guys are cool. Robot equal rights, I'm all for, just in case.
What are they going to do? You'll be dead. They're going to, like, dig you up and then...
You don't know that. Technology moves so quick. Maybe I'll be 50 and robots will have taken over. Again, I'm for that. You know, if you guys... Cool. That's cool. Top of the food chain at that point, right?
Hashtag pro-robot. Hashtag probot.
I'm sure hashtags will still be a thing by then. I'm sure. There's no way it's a trend.
They're not going to go away in like a year or so. Be a new thing. I love, one of my favorite things is when if you talk to like younger kids now and you show them an old phone, they ask why a hashtag is on there.
No way, really?
Because there's no pound sign. I mean, there are pound signs on cell phones, but you don't use them like you used to. So they see a pound sign and they think that it's a hashtag.
I have people actually my age call that a hashtag now instead of a pound symbol.
No, it's a pound symbol. But another funny story talking about pound symbols. I had somebody at work once was typing up a menu and they had to put 1 pound, but instead of putting LB to abbreviate pound, they put the pound symbol. And I was looking at this trying to like make this recipe and I'm like, is that supposed to be a pound? Because that's not how you abbreviate it. FYI. But he was older, so for him, a pound was the pound symbol.
He's like, was the information conveyed? Okay, then.
I'm like, well, yeah, but incorrectly. Like, a younger person will be like, 1 hashtag, what?
That's true, they would. They would think it's a typo.
Yeah.
Okay, enough about our week. People want to hear about Nintendo, yes. Which we're going to talk about video games first. And that is with Nintendo's latest Nintendo Direct, which went up on March 3rd, showcasing their Nintendo Wii U and 3DS titles through the summer. One of the things I heard was, and they said it ahead of time, we're going to highlight titles from this summer. And after the Direct came and went, they said, they didn't show any NX things. They didn't show any Zelda things.
You said through the summer, bitches.
Fucking summer. How many Nintendo Directs do they do a year? Like you should all be of used them. To this shit. Like every season they have a Nintendo Direct. No, but they didn't show it. Wait like a month. They'll probably have another one then.
First world problems. They didn't show me my new virtual video game that I can just play from my bed or the toilet.
With these awesome graphics and better gameplay.
With hours of entertainment for a relatively low cost.
Yeah, $60 games, it stayed there. Mm-hmm. To the credit of video games, they haven't gone up.
So one game that I would pay way more than $60 for, because as longtime Brocast listeners know...
The OG Brocast.
They'd be the OBs.
OBs.
The original Brocast. As you OBs know. Rhythm Heaven Mega Mix was confirmed to arrive on the 3DS sometime this year.
We did not know if it was going to come to North America.
I knew it was going to come to North America.
But it will feature 100 rhythm games.
Yes.
70 of which are from the previous Rhythm Heaven games.
Yes.
So 30% of these are new. Do you care?
No. They could have just re-released all the old ones. I still would have bought that bitch. I fucking love that game.
So explain to broquettes that haven't played Rhythm Heaven how the gameplay works on those.
Oh, man. It's rhythm games. And then you gotta, like, tap the screen or flick the screen or do something to the rhythm of the game to do things within it. Like, it's a bunch of little mini-games, essentially. Mm-hmm. So my favorite one goes, you're building things, and it goes to the rhythm of, like, do, re, mi, fa, so. And then when you get to so, that's when you flick the screen, and then you drive like a pin through a bolt, and then it just keeps going. But the way they format these games is just so much fun, because they've constructed music with these beats, and all of it's original, and all the characters are colorful, and then you have challenges, so then you could get a perfect on it. And then you get a special little medal, which unlocks different kind of games that aren't, like, I don't know, it's hard to describe. Really, unless you actually play the game. But I've always really liked rhythm. I've always been really good at picking up rhythm and following rhythm. So for me, it's a lot of fun. And it's kind of a game you can play with your eyes closed. There were actually... So the old one, just Rhythm Heaven, for the DS? 3DS.
There was one on the DS. There hasn't been one on the 3DS yet.
So Rhythm Heaven for the DS. There was one game where you have to tap to the beat. And then it randomly switches to the offbeat, and you have to switch to the offbeat. This was the hardest motherfucking game ever. Like, hardest thing I've ever played. so difficult, and I literally had to play with my eyes closed, mm-hmm. with the game underneath the table, and just listen and tap, and that was the only way that I could pass it, and I got a gold medal on it because I did so well. But there's like a little space shooter game in there, and then they had the one for the Wii, which was so much fun also. Unfortunately, I haven't beaten that one yet. I'm gonna have to hop on it before this game comes out. But if you like rhythm, then you're gonna love this game because it's just so much fun.
I would also compare it to the WarioWare games. If you have any of those, yeah. and if you're a fan of them, this very much relates to it. Because mm-hmm. you can play this for 2 minutes at a time if you wanted to and then move on.
Except I don't. I play for like 5 hours at a time.
The original Rhythm Heaven came out there in that period where Nintendo was trying to appeal to the workers out there mm-hmm. with their DS. Hey, do you only have 5 minutes to spare? Buy these games. Get the Brain Age games. Get Rhythm Heaven.
Yeah.
Get WarioWare. And you can just spend 5 minutes, play, and then put it away and then go to work. And especially for people that commute, it would be perfect for them.
Mm-hmm.
But more from the Nintendo Direct. Starting this month, a handful of Super Nintendo titles will be hitting the 3DS's virtual console.
So available now, we have Pillow Twings.
That is the best name that you gave it, Pillow Twings.
It's Pilot Wings, but I'm not even going to lie, guys. For the longest time, I thought this was Pillow Twings. And so now I just call it Pillow Twings because that's all that I see. I don't know why they mushed those two words together.
I hope other broquettes catch on and they're like, you know what? Yeah, Pillow Twings.
Yeah, Pillow Twings. I think that's a great name.
It's a funner name.
I would name something Pillow Twings and then people would be like, oh, Pilot Wings. Let me get this. I don't know who buys that game. And then I could be like, eh, surprise, bitch, this is Pillow Twings. So we have Pillow Twings. We have Super Mario World and F-Zero.
On March 24th, we'll have Super Mario Kart, Earthbound, huge one right there, and Donkey Kong Country. Even though that was developed by Rare, it belongs to Nintendo.
And then on April 14th, we'll have The Legend of Zelda, A Link to the Past, Super Metroid, and Donkey Kong Country 2.
On these releases, players will be able to play them in perfect pixel mode, which lets you play these classic titles in their original resolution.
That's really cool. So, hey guys, you want a shittier version of this game? It's called nostalgia.
Confused quality for memories. And that's a selling point.
Yeah, it really is. Stop, I can't. Don't look at me. Stop.
These virtual console releases are exclusive, this is the downside, mm-hmm. to the new 3DS, mm. which is the one that released about 2 years ago.
I can't play my Pillow Twings on my regular 3DS.
You cannot. Consumers are speculating that the 3DS and 3DS XL weren't built with virtual console in mind.
Or Nintendo wants to sell more new 3DSs.
I've worked at GameStop for long enough to know, yes, Nintendo will pull shit like that.
Okay, because I feel like we've gotten a lot of virtual console games on my DS already, and every time I download one, it says, this is going to eat up 83 blocks, and I'm like, shit, that's a lot. And then it's like, you still have 7,000 blocks left. I'm like, oh. Thanks.
Exclusivity was the biggest problem from this, and I'm going to side with the majority on it and say, yeah, you should have brought this out and made this available on all consoles. I'm glad you think that Super Mario Kart, Pillow Twings, Super Mario World are strong enough titles to sell consoles, but I'm going to tell you they are not. No one is looking at these and saying, oh, let me get a new 3DS so I can play these on the go. That's not the case. Instead, they're saying, well, I guess I'm just not buying these.
You want to know what's going to happen? They're going to release it only on the new 3DS for, I don't know, a few months. And then they're going to release on the regular 3DS.
Nintendo's pretty stubborn. If they're going to release it on regular consoles, it'll probably be at least a year from now.
Well, whatever. It's still going to get there. Don't worry, guys. Your Pillow Twings is safe. You will get it eventually.
The most controversial one of all of these Nintendo titles in the Nintendo Direct was Metroid Prime Federation Force.
Players will be able to play a demo at WonderCon this month, and I'm sure we will hear many more negative things at that time.
Metroid Prime series producer Kensuke Tanabe introduced this direct's Metroid trailer, along with a brief history on the creation of the latest in the Prime series. So this was almost sad to watch, because Federation Force had such a negative reaction at E3. People hated that this game existed. They didn't want to play this. People have been clamoring for a traditional Metroid series for quite some time now. And we haven't had that since, I believe, Fusion. No, Metroid Zero was the one right after Fusion. But nothing 2D like that has released since then. We've had a couple of Metroid Prime titles. But other than that, it's just been regular. Other M was another disappointment for a lot of players out there. And when they announced Federation Force, it was completely the opposite of what people wanted. You didn't play as Samus. It was more of a cooperative experience, kind of like a dungeon crawler. And Nintendo definitely heard people. And this is why they had the producer come out and say, guys, we've been working on this since 2011. This isn't something that we just started on 2 years ago. It's something that was originally going to come out on the DSi, and we ported it over to the 3DS because we could do way more on that console. And that was the Metroid title we were working on. Unfortunately, it just happens to come out at the wrong time when people are really wanting a traditional Metroid experience. When this came out separately as a trailer on their YouTube channel, it got downvoted to oblivion within seconds.
Oh no, this extracurricular awesome thing that's coming out isn't to my liking. I guess I'll just go play with sticks instead. Really?
The hoop and the stick.
The hoop and the stick.
I would have loved to play that, actually, just to see how that works.
The ball in the cup, like...
I played with that as a kid,
I know, actually. It was fucking great. I was awesome at it. Every time I was like... I'd be talking to people and just be like... Yeah? Goes this ball in a cup?
I was going to say, I'm a first-generation child to this country, so I'm like, that's what we had, you know? We weren't really well off at right. all, and I'm like, oh, shit, you had that too? Well, all right, I guess that was just a normal thing in this country. Whoa.
Okay, so, I mean, you talk like I was well off growing up as a kid, too. I wasn't.
The things you say you played with, I'm like, oh, man, I wish I had that. I wish I played with
that. What kind of things?
I don't know, when we point out, like, the nostalgia things, like the thing with the... The thing that they always had at the doctor's office where it was this wooden board and it had all these wires and then you had the wooden ball.
I didn't own one of those. I played it at the doctor's office. Like the one time a year my mom took me because I was deathly ill and we couldn't afford to go any other time.
Did you ever have an electric car thing? Like the big wheels?
No.
Okay, well, fine.
I didn't even have the big wheel that you sat in and had to paddle. I went over to my best friend's house who had the electric car. But I had to ride passenger. I couldn't even drive that shit.
Okay, well then you are lucky that you were in the vicinity of people that were well off, because I wasn't. Like, I was in the neighborhood where my dad's car would have a broken window every other month because they would try to steal something that wasn't there. That's the neighborhood I was in.
Well, I mean, that kind of happened to my dad too.
Every other month? Bullshit. I was in downtown, not even downtown Chicago, outside of Chicago.
Okay, well, I lived in a very not good part of Orlando.
Well, how's this relating to Metroid, though?
I don't know, because we're talking about, like, video games and how well off people are.
The ball
in
the hoop,
and now.
That's right, the ball in the cup, all right.
And then the stick in the hoop and the rocks.
So when are we supposed to have Federation Force?
It will be releasing on the 3DS in late spring 2016, so within the next few months.
It is my turn for this one.
Yes?
Nerd Rage Reaction!
You're so good at that. I feel like you're really turning Super Saiyan in those moments.
We have two of them for this story because we had to double it on poor Metroid Prime,
yes.
Which I'm not going to buy, but still poor Federation Force, just because I saw the producer like begging with his eyes and his face, please guys, stop it.
Just please. Sir, please.
He was like a pedophile from To Catch a Predator after he's been caught. Like, he just feels so sad and desperate.
For those of you who don't know, our Nerd Raid reaction is a reaction from the internet on whatever article we may be talking about. We don't give any names. You guys are welcome to go look them up if you really want to. But it's just things that we feel are ridiculous. Like, really, guys?
We'll pick out a comment, copy and paste it onto our notes, and we have our Nerd Rage reaction. So the first one.
Guess Nintendo has no interest in making good Metroid games anymore.
Oh, so this person's played it. He played it from beginning to end, he knows this is not a good Metroid game. He must have known
that this is just a terrible game.
Second one says, I feel sorry for the development team having to work on something so stupid.
Oh, this person's played it too.
Oh, man, it must have been like a wide beta.
I guess. They just realized it's, you know, stupid also. And, you know, I guess they didn't get a paycheck either because he feels sorry for them having to work on.
That's right. The development team was forced to work on this.
Right. This was just free. They did this out of their own goodwill and it was stupid. So, man.
The development team was, while they were working on it, they knew it was a dumb thing to work on.
Clearly just not doing what they loved.
They weren't working hard on it.
No,
right.
They were just suffering.
No. Mm-mm.
And that probably led into it being so stupid. You know,
cause yeah, they just didn't give a shit.
When I work on things I don't like, I don't work less than half-assed. Yeah.
Especially if you're getting paid.
They just, can you right cheek it? Can we call it that? Like, if it's half-assed, can we just call it that?
And then they sent it to these two individuals, and then they beat it, everything 100%. Mm-hmm. And then they determined this before they wrote this comment out on this video.
Clearly, because I mean that's the only way you could write something like this if you had definitive proof.
Yeah, no one in the right mind would just write something like this. It makes no sense.
It'd be like me like watching a movie trailer and being like, "Batman v
Superman, right now."
So stupid, like stupid, because I've seen it.
Clearly. Yeah, you've seen it. It's not a good movie.
Guys, that's my review. Stupid.
Stupid. It should be on the back of the DVD. stupid. Kelly, the reasons I'm broke.
Oh, I'd be so happy.
The most sane comment I saw on Metroid Prime Federation Force was, guys, this is not what we want to see, so don't purchase it. And that is really what it comes down to. If this is really not the game that you've been waiting for, and trust me, they know by now. And Reggie, this last summer, I keep thinking it's 2015, said that we are well aware that you want a traditional Metroid experience. And that's all he had to say about it. And that's as close to confirming that there is something right now in the works for a Metroid game. Unfortunately, that's going to confirm to a lot of these people that have been the loudest to say it's okay to continue to hate on something because they said, oh, look, they gave me what I wanted after the fact.
Here's the thing. If you are a game developer, I feel like making games really has to be your passion. And if you get the opportunity to work on something like Metroid, again, I feel that that has to be something that you're excited for and, again, passionate about. I mean, am I wrong in thinking that?
No, not at all.
For the most part, that's what I feel. So if this is the game that the people who are developing it really feels need to be made and something they really need to put out, then just let them fucking put it out. If you try it, maybe you rent it from Blockbuster, which no longer exists, but you know, you try it or you just choose not to purchase it, that's fine. But give these people the satisfaction of putting out the game that they have worked 5 years on now, putting in everything they can into it, and something that's really their passion. Don't just knock it down and say it's stupid.
One of the couple of new titles that were given to us with the Nintendo Direct. And if you want to see the full Nintendo Direct, you're more than welcome to. There was also a Kirby title where Kirby is in a machine. And that looks really cool too. No complaints there. But this one, Paper Mario Color Splash, is another one that people also didn't react well to. And I didn't really understand where that came from. This is going to come out this year sometime. They didn't specify. On the Wii U. So it's another Paper Mario title. Obviously, mm-hmm. they're selling somewhat well if they're mm-hmm. still making these. And there's a fan base out there for this. And if this is not the Mario title you were looking for, trust me, there's plenty more in development because it's fucking Mario. He'll be on a cart soon. Oh, that's not the one you like? He'll be in 3D soon. Oh, that's not the one you like? He'll be in an RPG title, which is coming out this year.
Another game that Daniel is most excited for.
This was the focus of the Direct.
Well, we'll just touch on it briefly. We don't need to talk a lot about it. We'll just...
They said summer, and this is their summer title.
Okay, well, we'll just... Real quick, and we won't expand a lot, guys, because I know Daniel's probably the only one excited for this. Star Fox Zero got confirmed release date of April 22nd, 2016. Now, guys, we can move on to our Hulu highlights. We'll just...
No, not quite.
Just move along. But I mean, what else are we going to say? There it is.
Well, let's do a U-turn here and go back.
Let's just do a barrel roll and go back. Is that how you go backwards? Do you do a barrel roll?
If that's what it takes to go back, yes, it's a barrel roll. The game will feature different paths on each planet and the familiar story to that of Star Fox 64.
Huh. Well, it sounds like it'll be a great game. So, we'll just move on.
I did like Star Fox 64.
I know. You did more than like that game. Your Star Fox 64 is to you what Pokemon Snap is to me.
Are you sure that's not Resident Evil 4 for me? I really like Star Fox 64. That's probably my second or third favorite game of all time, but...
Well, I don't know that I'd say Pokemon Snap is my favorite game of all time.
In your top five?
I mean, it's way up there. It's probably like in my top three. Really like that game. So in addition to these different paths on each planet, different portals will also alter the levels, which are featured heavily in the plot.
In other interviews with Miyamoto after the Direct, he did say that this had to do with Andross. So it's possible that we're seeing different versions of Andross in this game, and he is somehow affecting the timeline in the Star Fox universe. Along with Star Fox Zero, the game will come bundled with an additional game called Star Fox Guard.
Originally a standalone game shown at E3, Star Fox Guard will feature over 100 maps in which Slippy Toad.
Well done, Kelli.
Tipsy Toad, in which Tipsy Toad must guard the base using security cameras and gun towers. I don't know how he's going to do that if he's so tipsy.
Well, that's why you're helping him. You're the player.
Okay, there we go. Can he just like make drunken slurs the whole time, dude?
The further you get, the more racist he gets.
The more drunk Tipsy Toad gets. This is a great game. Somebody please create this for me.
Players will be able to upload their own custom enemy patterns into Star Fox Guard for others to download and try out.
Game styles like this are real big right now. That's a smart move.
Super Mario Maker, huge mm-hmm. for Nintendo, and this is going to take...
Well, even Little Big Planet, where you made your own levels, and people like those tower defense games a lot, so...
I definitely do, yeah.
Like, we have zombies and plants and things...
This was originally a Miyamoto title that mm-hmm. he showed at E3, and it didn't have any Star Fox anything on it. It was very plain, kind of like an original IP, but at some point they decided, well, we probably can't charge $60 for this, so let's bundle it with Star Fox.
They went, well, Slippy's kind of stupid, so let's try and make him more relevant.
If you buy Star Fox Zero digitally, you have the option of getting the one with the Star Fox Guard game, or just Star Fox Zero by itself. So it's kind of like what they did with Bayonetta 2, in which if you bought it retail, you got two discs with Bayonetta 1 and 2 on Blu-ray, or you can get it digitally, in which you'd pay, I think, $30 for Bayonetta 2. So if you want Star Fox Zero cheaper, most likely if you get it digitally, it will cost you about $40, and then you get Star Fox Guard for an additional $20 or $10.
Not bad. I still wish they would make him Tipsy Toad, though. I want them to create my game and put the Ocean Master in it.
Some of the things I noticed as a Star Fox 64 fan watching the game trailer and everything was that they took a lot of the classic lines from Star Fox 64 and brought them back in this one.
Do a barrel roll.
Do a barrel roll has to be in there. We've also got Cat, who will be in this game. Cat Monroe was her name. And she was just an additional character, appeared twice in Star Fox 64, depending on the paths you took and how successful you were in them. But she is going to appear in this one again, which is awesome, which tells me that they will hopefully have more than just the Star Fox and the Star Wolf team. Maybe even characters that were cut from Star Fox 2.
Like Tipsy Toad and Bunny Rabbit.
That's Pepper Hare.
Yes, Pepper Hare. And...
Falco Lombardi.
And Captain Falcon.
Fox McCloud.
And Star Fox. And the Big Bad Wolf.
In spite of how bad Star Fox Zero is.
And Krang.
I'm still going to play it from beginning to end. Because I did that with Star Fox Adventures. I did that with Star Fox Assault. All of these I play from beginning to end. I even did that with the Star Fox Command game. Which was originally what Star Fox 2 was sort of going to be like.
And Martian Manhunter.
I don't even know who Martian Manhunter is.
You know who Martian Manhunter is?
Not in the Star Fox universe.
He's in there now. I put him there. I'm calling Nintendo as soon as this podcast is over and saying, scrap the game, we're starting over.
Now we can finally move on to Hulu highlights.
Yes. So new on Hulu this month, March 2016, we have some James Bond films.
Tons of James Bond. Lots if you want the them. Full list... Just type in on Google, new on Hulu, March 2016. But these are some of the titles that are coming out that do relate to the podcast.
First up, Dr. No.
For Your Eyes Only.
From Russia with Love.
License to Kill.
Tomorrow Never Dies.
Moonraker.
And GoldenEye.
One of the best movie title video games, movie tie-in video games, mm-hmm. was GoldenEye. It still goes down on many people's lists as the best first-person shooter out there. Also on Hulu this month is Louis Season 5, which we knew was coming on Netflix too, but if you only have Hulu, you can also check it out on there, although I do recommend getting it on Netflix so you do have it ad-free.
I haven't seen any of these James Bond films, so I may have to have a binge-watching day, which, by the way, I started a new job this week, which is really cool, and they sent me a survey like, oh, what's your favorite, like, how do you relax? And the only thing I could think of was binge watch Netflix. And so that's what I put.
That's another thing that I feel like in 10 years is going to be an age. That's a 2010s thing.
Binge watching Netflix, yeah.
We talked about nostalgia earlier. People my age especially relate to stuff in the 80s. Well, you're going to have to tune into Nickelodeon this month for some classic TMNT.
Don't be saying people your age relate to stuff in the 80s. You were barely alive in the 80s.
Kelly, when was I born?
88.
Which is in the...
late 80s, practically 90s.
Look, you're adding extra information and you don't need to. 80s.
No, I'm just stating the facts. You were born in the 90s. How much of the 80s do you remember?
I remember Aliens. I remember Alien.
Did you see those in the 80s or did you see those in the 90s?
I don't remember. It was so long ago. What do you remember
from when you were 2 years old? You don't remember shit when you were 2 years old. Not even. You were a year old.
The fact is, I was born in the 80s, so all the content that I did consume were from the 80s.
Here's the thing. You were born mid-year in 88. So by the time the 90s rolled around, you were a year and a half old. You didn't even know how to, like, shit in the toilet. You were still going in your diaper. You probably couldn't even speak. You could barely walk.
Well, look, in spite of this, the content wasn't there in the 90s yet, so I consumed a lot of stuff from the 80s. And that's why you talked to me about 80s. I'm like, oh, shit, yeah, I remember that.
You don't remember jack shit from the 80s.
I was watching 80s shit in the early 90s.
Okay, that's fine, but you weren't watching 80 things in Bucky the 80s. Bucky O'Hare? Okay, that's fine. You don't know what that is. You're still watching them in the 90s. You're watching them in the 90s, not the 80s, so it doesn't count.
I'm an 80s baby. My mom was huge on 80s, hence she showed me 80s shit.
You're like a late 80s baby. It doesn't even count.
The full cast of the 1980s Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, which is the one I grew up on, that cartoon, those members of that cast, of that cartoon, will be reprising their roles on March 27th episode, 2 days after Batman v Superman, of Nickelodeon's Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
I appreciate how you just ignored me and moved on with the conversation.
News has to continue, Kelly.
You have learned to navigate marriage very well.
We've got a press release.
Yes, in a press release, Nickelodeon said, "This is a new half-hour episode. The turtles are transported to another dimension where they meet their 80s alternate reality counterparts. Actor Pat Fraley also reunites with the 80s cast for the first time since the original series premiered to reprise his role as Krang."
The 80s Turtles last appeared in a TV special titled Turtles Forever. Now, the 80s Turtles last appeared in the special. This was a special that did not have the original voice actors. Mm-hmm. I remember watching this. It was up on YouTube for free for everyone to watch, and it did not have the original cast. While it was nice to see the old turtles and see how goofy they were back then, the contract, unfortunately, didn't allow for a lot of these actors to return. Now, I feel like they're doing it right, in which we're having all of those original characters, and one of which, the actors, he played Raphael in the 80s, and who's he playing in the new cartoon?
Donatello.
So there has to be a joke somewhere in there about how they both sound exactly the same.
Because they do. He didn't even try to change his voice.
I am extremely excited for this, and mm-hmm. if you haven't been watching Nickelodeon's TMNT, you are missing out because it is a very fun show, and it connects very well to IDW's current comic book, which is the closest iteration to the original comic that we've seen.
I feel like this show is doing really well. I know we used to watch it a lot, and unfortunately, we don't have cable in our house, so it's difficult just to keep up with stuff on Hulu, let alone cable, where we have to travel to somebody else's house, you know, to watch it. But I see little kids all the time with all their turtle stuff, and, you know, there's the toys and the merchandise and the shirts, all for this TV show. So I'm glad it's doing so well, because when we did watch it, I thought it was a great show. It's great for kids and adults.
So March 27th, everyone, take a break from rewatching Batman v Superman and check out this TMNT special. For the 14th time
in 3 days.
I've got some news here, courtesy of FloridaGeekScene.com. Mm-hmm. This one we are covering on behalf of them. If you go to FloridaGeekScene.com, you can check out some more nerd news, all kinds of podcasts, including ours, which we do thank FloridaGeekScene.com for featuring The Reasons I'm Broke on their website. So we've got, throughout the country, bigger than last year, this is the second one that they've ever done, and this was done at my comic shop as well. It's the InStore Convention Kick-Off 2016.
Why don't you explain to our brokettes what this InStore Convention is?
Essentially, this is a convention without the lines. So what they mean by that is you can go to your local comic book shop that is participating in this, and you can watch the panels, so to say, the interviews with huge creators from the comfort of your local comic book shop. So as opposed to a convention where you go to a panel and hope to actually get a decent seat with this, for this one, because it is nationwide and it is streaming, you don't have to worry about the room being too packed and you don't catch everything. They also even gave you exclusive variants that you can buy for this event. There was a Batman Arkham Knight, Batgirl and Harley special, there was Jonesy number 1, and there was the Power Man and Iron Fist special. So the major companies had something to offer for attendees of the InStore Convention Kickoff.
So just to list off some highlights that you saw if you were at the InStore Convention or if you're rewatching it, Jim Zub, who's worked on Samurai Jack and Wayward, showed off his upcoming Street Fighter spin-off comic miniseries, Street Fighter Legends Cammy.
Cammy is one of the more popular characters in the Street Fighter universe, and one of the characters that they developed since this Street Fighter comic debuted many, many years ago, as Udon Entertainment has been doing for years since then. It's still the same continuity, same story, which we've reviewed Street Fighter Unlimited before. Great story. The artwork isn't as strong as it used to be, but it's probably because they aren't getting as many funds. It's almost like they're redoing it from the beginning, just because they did do only hardcovers up to this point. But now you have talent like Jim Zub, so it's kind of ramping up again. And Samurai Jack, we really liked, even though it's now out of continuity based on what they're doing with the Samurai Jack TV show. Cammy should do pretty well.
DC also let us know they will not be cutting down their page count for their bi-weekly $2.99 titles.
That was one of the major concerns with a lot of consumers out there. They said, okay, they're drawing the line back at $2.99 again, but are they going to give us less pages and more ads? These titles will be no fewer than 20 pages long, and that was courtesy of Jim Lee when he was doing his portion of the interview at the InStore convention. That is huge. I mean, if you are behind and you are being outsold 2-to-1 and you are doing a mini relaunch of sorts, even though it's not a reboot, you have to cater to, yes, this is bi-weekly, but guess what? As we determined last week, $2 extra a month that you're paying for an additional book, so it's not even double the price, and we're not cutting down on the page count.
I feel like that's really smart. They could have changed it and still made some money, but this is the way to keep people happy.
Unfortunately, people won't notice it and be like, oh, well, I got my 20 pages. It just doesn't work that way, unfortunately. But hopefully brokettes at least are educated in that aspect and that, oh, okay, cool. It's going to be no less than 20.
Right. Dan DiDio also made it clear that DC will be returning to their focus on continuity with Rebirth.
Their DCU line had previously made a move to loosen up on this asset. So I've always been a big proponent of who gives a shit about continuity. Just tell a good story if you can. If not, again, it doesn't guarantee sales, as I said last week or 2 weeks ago. You're not going to be selling millions of books, thousands of books, because you have a good story. But you should focus on that if you can, when you can. Unfortunately, a lot of consumers think, where does this fit in this timeline? And it's like, who gives a shit? Just enjoy the comic, enjoy the story. Unfortunately, that's not what consumers want. And that's why Dan DiDio said, we're going to go back and focus on continuity, and since that is important to people out there for whatever reason. I feel like it's in the older readers that they care the most about. Does it give them significance if they're buying these comics that they've invested in years? Is that what it is, that they think, I have to justify the fact that I have stayed with this comic for so many years, and now it's no longer fitting in what I used to buy? I don't understand where that disconnect is.
People have a hard time with change, And that's ultimately what it boils down to.
It also reflects in that whole thing about TV and movies not fitting in the mm-hmm. same universe. I hear that all the fucking time about, well, why doesn't DC just put the television show in the movie universe? And I know they're saying that because a bigger company has already done it in the past with Marvel. But why do the things have to fit? What if they're both good things? Why can't you just enjoy the two things as they are?
I feel like as humans, we're always looking for things to fit together and things to have some sort of consistency. And yeah, that's hard when that's not there. And I understand it. It doesn't bother me because I know how to separate the two. And because we're so involved in that world, it's very easy to separate the two for us, I feel like.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're, you know, constantly talking about these things. But, you know, for a lot of people, if they're just... They may go in and see the movie and say, I really like this. I want to see where the story continues, and goes and picks up the book and realizes it's not the same thing. You know, in their mind, the Avengers, everything is the same as far as the Avengers. And, you know, of course, we know that it's not because we are immersed in both worlds, but not many people are.
The last bit of DC news, and also from the InStore convention, was that Jimmy Palmiotti, who we adore, mm-hmm. and also Amanda Connor, Jimmy Palmiotti announced that Neil Adams will be redrawing the classic Superman versus Muhammad Ali, although this time it will feature Harley Quinn.
That's so cool!
That is the one that's going to be after Zatanna, which we're going to see next. So this will be during the period in which Rebirth will be launching.
Mm-hmm.
That almost tells me that Harley's Little Black Book will in fact be continuing outside of this Rebirth title or relaunch.
I mean, it makes money. There's no reason that they shouldn't continue it.
That's what I was saying. And you were saying that they couldn't, that maybe they'd run out of characters and all this other stuff. It has to continue. That's what I've been saying, too. As many Harley Quinn books as you can publish, do it, because right now it's hot. That's what I love about this, too, is that I can listen back and be like, actually, you said this.
And then I can say, do you like it when I cook you dinner?
And done.
Do you like your laundry being folded?
How much do you think Neil Adams is charging them for this?
A bajillion dollars. Why not? I mean... You saw him at the convention.
He likes his money. That's what I'm going to say about that.
Yep, man loves his money.
Overall, the InStore convention was an improvement over the first year, which of course it will be, because the first time you try to do something, it's not going to be at its full potential.
Mm-hmm.
You're taking your first step, which is always the hardest part. It's just taking that first leap. And right after that, everything else becomes a building process. You're building up. It's just like when we first did the podcast. It's the first episode's not going to be the strongest. And then from there, you kind of figure out what works and what doesn't as you build your audience and go from there. So I feel like the InStore convention gave us better news this year. The tech side of it was better. The host was better, although I still think they could have gotten a more charismatic host. Mm-hmm. For the InStore convention, especially when they're talking to people like Jimmy Palmiotti, who's used to talking in front of crowds.
Right.
Some of these guests weren't as strong. I'm not going to call out any creators or artists out there, but they're not used to talking in front of people. They're not used to talking in crowds, or maybe they've only done a couple of panels. So that's where the host has to kind of pick it up and make it more colorful and bring the energy up. So maybe next year they'll get someone that's a little bit more involved in that aspect of it. But overall, the 2016 InStore convention was a stronger showing for comic shops out there.
Keeping with some comic news, but now on the big screen as opposed to in the books or the small screen. In spite of the success of the rated R Deadpool, Disney chairman Bob Iger had this to say to shareholders.
Quote, we don't have any plans to make R-rated Marvel movies, end quote.
Not surprised.
No, they haven't had anything R-rated, at least on the big screen, from Marvel Studios.
Mm-hmm. I don't really feel that they need to make something R-rated.
They currently do have TVMA content with Netflix's Daredevil and Jessica Jones, but they're leaving their films at PG-13 for now.
I understand why. I don't see this as a negative. I don't see why this is anything to talk about. Like, what are people like, oh, well, you should, like... They're still making money.
Well, I think this is news. I saw one comment that said, in other words, water is still wet and the sky is still blue.
Yeah.
But it's news because a lot of studios are making that move of, okay, what kind of properties do we have right now that would fit under the R rating movie? Because we can make that and we can still make millions of dollars if we rate something R. We're not necessarily going to lose out on as much as we initially thought. Before, you would have like a Punisher movie that you'd have to bring down to PG-13 so you could reach a wider audience, which I still agree with. You want to hit as many people as you possibly can with your ticket sales. And in his case, he's saying, well, let's all keep it at PG-13. It's been working just fine. Mm-hmm. We don't have to move something up to rated R just because we think that that's where the money's at. And I don't think many movie studios are necessarily doing that with existing properties. Maybe they're doing an R-rated version, as we saw with Batman v Superman on home video release. But what we're seeing on the big screen is still PG-13. And we'll probably still continue to get that with the DCU. However, other studios are now saying, like Sony, hey, we've got this Venom movie. That would probably fit fine with rated R, because you see the symbiote and Eddie Brock, who rips skulls open and eats their brains, because that's what symbiotes, that's what the symbiote feeds on. And you probably couldn't do that with PG-13. And
probably not.
Especially with Carnage. If you're going to put Carnage in a Venom movie, that is a serial killer with the symbiote in him. That is a hard R right there.
At the end of the day, of course, Disney knows that they don't need to make this rated R to make any money. They're going to continue to make money exactly how they are.
On to the latest in the DCU film universe.
Suicide Squad actress Margot Robbie recently revealed that they tried different costumes for her role as Harley Quinn.
Quote here from Margot. We tried the court jester costume. We tried the corset and skirt. We tried leather pants. We tried literally every type of costume possible for her. I really love where we ended up. And who knows, maybe in the sequels we'll go with the court jester one. I think there's a world of possibilities.
I love that.
I love that too.
That's great. I would love to see her court jester, even if it's just in a flashback. Even if she steps in front of a mirror and the costume's reflected with her face or something along those lines. I just think it would be great to see.
That's exactly what I told one of our Twitter followers, is even if we get a little montage of her trying out different things as like a little joke, like a little reference. I think we live in a world where now you can reference the different versions of Harley Quinn, mm-hmm. and fans will pick up on it. And even audience members that don't really, they haven't played the Arkham game, so they wouldn't catch the skirt and leotard one. And then not everyone watched Batman the Animated Series, believe it or not. So maybe they wouldn't really recognize the red and black outfit. But it's now a reference that you can do that everyone can enjoy. You can mm-hmm. hit the comic fans and you can hit the casual viewers as well.
The movie is still set to release August 5th, 2016.
To make it clear for new broquettes out there, what is our favorite version of Harleen Quinzel?
Clearly Batman the Animated Series with her gesture costume.
The one objection I've heard to that is that it wouldn't work on the big screen because it looks too silly. Silly. What does that mean, silly?
I don't know. Do they know who Harley Quinn is? Because she's pretty silly. She's pretty out there.
That's true. Yeah.
It is very fitting for her character.
People are saying that Harley Quinn has now shifted into more of like a sex symbol, like sexy, than silly.
She was kind of sexy before, though.
Yes, but she was more silly than sexy in the past, although there are both of those in there.
I mean, I get that. Of course, the direction they were trying to go in, you had the Joker who tries to make people laugh, ultimately, and of course a court jester tries to make people laugh, but at the same time, her name is Harley Quinn. Harlequin. Like, mm-hmm. she was dressed in Harlequin. So that's where the origin came from, and I get that you're trying to make her sexy and more on her own, but you can't forget her roots, too, and either way, that costume still fits very well with her character, whether it's now in 2016 or back then in the 90s.
I want to share Paul Dini's thoughts on... He's one of the co-creators of Harley mm-hmm. Quinn. I was listening to this really good episode of Fat Man on Batman. Anytime he has Paul Dini on, it's going to be a really, really good episode. And he, along with Bruce Timm, created Harley Quinn back with Batman the Animated Series as kind of a one-off character. And then from there, fans really grew to like her, and they started putting her into more and more episodes. But he was saying that Harley Quinn, to him, because he's coming out with this hardcover story of this traumatic experience that he had where he got mugged. And as he's retelling the story in comic book form, he puts in these other characters to represent different parts of his own mind. So Two-Face is that the duality in himself that says, you're not really this person that you're trying to make yourself to be. You're not really as confident as you think you are around women. You're really this wimpy guy. And then with Poison Ivy, it's making fun of his sex life, making fun of his appearance. And he said that a lot of people asked him, why didn't you include Harley Quinn in these villains that represent these different doubts in your mind? And he broke into tears, as he said, because Harley Quinn represents happiness and joy.
Aww, and he just broke down into that. That's so sweet.
And it was amazing. I got goosebumps. Yeah.
That's so sweet. Aw, I love... I mean, the character means a lot to a lot of people, but for her to mean that much to the creator, too, you know it's something special.
On to Justice League Part 1. It starts filming next month, so we're already getting news on who's going to be in this and what actors out there are going to play these roles.
So, something that blew my mind, made me so excited. J. Jonah Jameson from the shitty-ass Tobey Maguire Spider-Man movies.
Those were not shitty.
I didn't like them. J. Jonah Jameson will be moving over to Gotham City as Commissioner Gordon.
Boom!
Badass!
J.K. Simmons has been cast as GCPD's finest in next year's Justice League Part 1.
Yes! So what's he gonna do? Like, bring me the Joker!
I want pictures of the Joker!
I wish. He's also like Tenzin from Legend of Korra.
That's right, he
is. So he can teach her how to airbend.
He also won a fucking Oscar last year for that drum movie.
I never saw the drum movie.
It was fucking good.
Was
he did
which
amazing
drum
in
movie?
That. I know that's not the name of it, but it was where he's teaching. It's essentially like a band that he's teaching like a class in college in, and one of the kids becomes really obsessed with becoming the drum member that is picked in his class because his class, his band, is always the top of a certain contest and they always strive for the best. But it gets to the point where he's so obsessed with trying to become the best for this teacher that he goes overboard. Like, he's practicing so much that his hands are breaking down and bleeding. He dips them in ice to numb them so he can continue practicing. And JK tells him, that's when you know you're starting your practice and you're starting to get there to his level. It's not fast enough for him. And it's this amazing tale of obsession and almost redemption in showing this teacher what you can do. But then it flips near the end. It's so fucking good. The performances are amazing.
See, I was totally thinking of that drum movie with Mariah Carey's husband. What's his name? He was on Wild
Nick Cannon?
Yes. You don't remember he was in that drum movie?
No, I don't know which one you're talking about.
Okay, well, that's what
remember
I was thinking.
Remember the Titans? Is that what it was?
No, it was a drum movie. We're going to look up Nick Cannon drum movie, and you're going to not remember what I'm talking about, but that's okay.
Well, no, that whatever you're talking about did not win any Oscars. I can guarantee
I'm
you that.
I'm sure it wasn't even on any radar for any kind of award.
People are saying that this immediately killed any rumors, because there was a petition that went up a few weeks back of J.K. Simmons returning as J. Jonah Jameson in the Marvel Disney Spider-Man reboot.
Well, yeah, because he's awesome. I want him there, too. He can do this and that.
He even played Jameson in the Ultimate Spider-Man cartoon.
Yeah,
they
yeah,
got him back
I remember.
For that. I don't think he's going to be in any Spider-Man live-action movie at this point. Warner Brothers has him on lockdown as Gordon. I was saying on Twitter, he can play fucking Batman for all I care. He's such a good actor. And I didn't even think about the fact that, oh yeah, Jim Gordon is Batman right now. But yeah, make that happen too. I don't care.
Do it all. Fuck it. So filming is scheduled to begin next month, and the release date so far is November 17th, 2017.
Would that be weird to you to see like what Jameson, essentially Jameson, playing Gordon? Or do you think he's such a strong actor that he can do his own thing with Gordon?
He's definitely such a strong actor that he can do his own thing. Even when we were watching Legend of Korra and he was playing Tenzin, like the first time I was like, it's J. Jonah Jameson. Like, you know, I want to hear him say something, a throwback to that role. And of course he didn't, but you know, it's his voice that sounds exactly like him, but it was still such a different character.
Yes, it was a different performance.
Exactly.
It wasn't anything you had heard from. And so he can definitely transform, just like Gary Oldman did for the Nolan universe, as far as Batman goes with that. J.K. Simmons is bald.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to see him with a wig as Gordon? So do a true Gordon, just like what they're doing with the comics now, in which a lot of these characters are reflecting their comic counterparts, or just put him as is and you'll buy it as Gordon as long as he has the mustache.
I would definitely buy it as is if they threw him in there exactly how he is. I don't know what costuming or the writers or directors are going to decide is the best version of Gordon to put in this movie. Obviously, they're going to put a lot of thought and time into that and give us the best version or what they think is the best version to fit in this universe. And I'll be perfectly satisfied with whatever they choose.
So people may be wondering, okay, that's great. We know we're getting Gordon in the DCU. But what about Green Lantern? When are we going to see Green Lantern, and which version will it be?
So recent rumors about casting for some Green Lanterns in the upcoming Justice League movie may be nothing more than just that.
So it sounds like we're going a little bit backwards here. We knew we had some meetings with Warner Brothers on several actors to play Jon Stewart and Hal Jordan. But now, in a recent Interview Weekly interview with Warner Brothers President of Creative Development, Greg Silverman and producer Charles Roven, they had the following to say.
Quote, "I guess I can say to the Green Lantern fans, if they can be patient with us, I think they'll be really happy. Every beat of the movie is not yet worked out. So there's the possibility that he may or may not be in Justice League 2. For now, we felt that we were introducing enough characters that the best possible place we could put Green Lantern is some introduction in Justice League 2, or barring that, a movie after."
So at the earliest, they're saying Justice League 2, which is 2019, 2020, I think it was 2019. The Green Lantern core movie is still set to release in 2020. Good move or bad move?
I think it's a perfectly fine move. So let's say we're still, what, 6 years out from this movie?
We're in 2016, four years out.
So we're still a while out. You could rush and you could pick a Green Lantern that you may think is the best Green Lantern and have him sign a contract and appear in one of these movies and be the best you can find at this time, 4 years out from the movie releasing. Or you could take your time and really wait and not run into the issues like we did with the other Green Lantern movie that everybody hated. And yes, your character doesn't appear in this movie. Your character may appear 3 years from now, but you know you have the best that you can possibly get and the one that you need. Because the script's probably still being written or rewritten.
Right.
Or altered. And so they may start out and say, Hal Jordan is the best for what we have. And then they continue to work on the script and say, you know what? No, let's do a Jon Stewart. Because Jon Stewart's something we haven't seen. And we have a great story for him that we hadn't thought of a year ago when we were trying to pick an actor.
And plus, Neil Adams keeps knocking on our door and saying, give me more money. Use Jon Stewart.
That guy likes his money.
Yeah, I think it is the fact of them saying, okay, we didn't do right for Green Lantern in the eyes of a lot of people. Let's take our time with this character. Let's let the other Green Lantern really get out of the minds of people. And especially with the Green Lantern universe, there are so many directions that you can do. It would really open up a huge amount of sequels and movies and possibilities with that universe alone. I think that kicks off the prediction that we had, or what we wanted to see with one of the Justice League movies, in that do the Sinestro Corps War, because that is a Justice League size problem for the team. You can have Sinestro and his Corps try to just recreate the book, but then include the Justice League in this along with Hal Jordan. If you want to make the focus Hal Jordan or Jon Stewart, great, but that's a big enough threat. I don't think we're going to see that now. I don't think we'll see the Sinestro Corps even in 2020's Green Lantern Corps movie.
I agree. It would be a really good story to see on the big screen, but there's a lot of Green Lantern stories to be told. And,
true.
You know, just because we won't see that fantastic story on the big screen doesn't mean that the story they're going to give us won't be just as amazing.
So far, we've gotten our roster for Justice League. Mm-hmm. We've got Cyborg, The Flash, Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman, and I believe that's it. That's our main roster right now. If we're not going to see Green Lantern added for Justice League 1, and possibly not even Justice League 2, I think the other obvious choice right now is Shazam.
You forgot Aquaman. Did you say Aquaman?
Oh, yeah. I missed Aquaman. I'm sorry.
I think Shazam would be great. I would love to see a solo Shazam movie. It would just make me so happy.
I touched about this earlier. We got to give some news for the Marvel fans out there. Mm-hmm. And this was the biggest one as far as new entries into the Spider-Man universe.
So according to The Hollywood Reporter, Sony has revived Venom's solo film.
This has been news since I was in high school. People talking about a solo Venom film and something Sony was considering back when they had Topher Grace and Spider-Man 3.
So if this happens, this will be developed as its own separate franchise unrelated to the upcoming Spider-Man reboot being co-developed with Disney and Marvel Studios, aka Rated R.
That's your Rated R Spider-Man flick right there. I think they would have to jump through a lot of hoops to do this with Disney and Marvel Studios. There's no way they are letting a Venom movie fly unless they hit these checkpoints with Disney and with Marvel.
Of course, that's 100% the truth. I think this film will definitely happen, especially now that they've seen that films like Deadpool, which are rated R, can do very well. And I'm sure they know that there's a desire for this Venom movie. So I definitely think we'll see it. But working with Disney and Marvel, they're not going to support the things that they're wanting to do.
Venom, as much as people like Venom, he's not a big enough character for Disney to say, yeah, let's put him into this solo movie and finance it and make it happen. It's right. not going to happen. I'm sorry. Venom has a lot of fans out there and he's great, but it's not enough. It's not a Spider-Man figure right there. It's a character from the 80s, 90s especially, really blew up then. So it's simply not a franchise character and certainly not a character that has proven that can even hold his own movie.
Regardless, if Sony does hop on board and make this film, I think it's going to do really, really well. I don't think it'll do Deadpool numbers, but I still think it's going to pull in a fairly decent-sized crowd.
If this Venom movie does come about, a certain book out there, a certain comic of a war that is secret, will suddenly jump up in value. Something that maybe a certain someone or a certain shop out there should have purchased for at least $100.
The book we are speaking of is Secret Wars number 8. This is the first appearance of Black Suit Spidey, or the symbiote that later becomes Venom.
The origin of the symbiote.
Exactly. And recently on Comic Book Men, season 5, episode 9, titled Suburban Cowboys, we did see someone try to sell this book.
Now available on iTunes.
Yes,
now if you want to own this, which you should right now you should be clicking on iTunes and checking that
AMC.
Out.
Or AMC.com, you can watch it on there.
Yeah, but you can have it ad-free forever in full HD.
This is true, it's only like $3.
$3, that's
it. $3, it's perfect, that's all.
Less than a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
Your very own Kelli was on Comic Book Men.
I was. You were on there too. You were just in the back.
I was going through back issues, trying to find the next one.
you were sorting them, organizing them.
Trying not to, yeah.
So, yeah, something that we couldn't talk about with you Broquettes, and we apologize
killed
for
us.
That.
Killed us.
Back in July of last year.
August.
Really? I don't remember. So back in August of last year, Daniel and I had the opportunity to fly up to New Jersey and actually be on an episode of Comic Book Men. And it was a great and wonderful process. It was so cool. It was like probably the most fun that I had last year. That was my highlight of my last year.
It was a great, great experience. And when we shared those New York photos last year, that was our trip right around that time. And we went specifically for that reason. And of course, to see New York City. But we couldn't share any of the photos that I have been putting up on Twitter, Facebook, Tumblr, and Instagram of the stash. We got to go to the secret stash, go in there, go to shop. You bought a secret stash t-shirt.
It's like my favorite t-shirt. If it's me so perfect, it's like my fat day t-shirt. So when I want to eat a lot, I just put that on and it still makes me look skinny. It's awesome.
It's a staff on the back.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got to go to the secret stash. We got to go to New York City, which we couldn't talk about that trip up until this point. So I don't think we even talked about Nintendo World while we were...
I think we kept everything very hush-hush. I mean, of course, we couldn't share it until the episode aired. And now it's aired, so, you know, many months later, we can try and remember.
Nintendo World used to be the Pokemon Center where we got to go there. Mm-hmm. We bought some exclusive merchandise. We got to go to New York City, which was a big deal for you because it was the first big city that you had been to.
Yeah, well, neither of us had been to New York City before. I know Daniel's from Chicago, grew up in the suburbs around there, so he's gotten to experience that city. But Orlando's kind of a small city, guys.
Yeah, it's not really. It's more like a neighborhood.
It's not that big. But regardless, yes, it was my first big city. But of course, New York City is the mecca of all big cities.
Sure.
And getting to experience that, and it was just, you had to keep pulling me along because you're like, okay, we got to go. And I'm like, just let me look at the buildings. They never stop.
I'm like, we got to go in city pace, in which it's almost like a power walk pace. Yep. Always moving. You got to keep moving. So I was used to that, having gone to Chicago so many times. And seeing you even experience that was pretty awesome. We got to go to Midtown Comics.
Yeah.
Which was one of the points in which I really wanted to visit and go to, because Midtown is always advertised in many comic books. It's always talked about as one of the biggest and best and most recognized comic books in the world. So to me, I had to go to see this. And working at a comic book shop, I'm like, well, let's scope this place out. And not to knock it down, because I work at a comic book store, but I'm like, this is not that great. Their comic book back issues were in shambles, and maybe it's because I work on back issues so often that I was like, all this is wrong. But then that's when I came to the conclusion that they're in New York City. They don't have to maintain things as strictly as a regular comic shop out there. The Secret Stash was a better maintained shop than the Midtown Comics that we visited. And again, I'm not knocking it down. I think it's great that they can just open up and have that kind of business and not have to really worry too much about the strict, super strict upkeep of your back issues, for example, which was still my biggest thing. But just to go, it was just kind of like, all right, well, this is Midtown.
We were there. And now we're leaving.
As far as the Secret Stash itself, yes, you see the Walrus suit right up there on display. You see the exclusive Kevin Smith merchandise. A lot of stuff. If you want something signed by Kevin Smith, it will be there. We got to meet the comic book crew, which Michael Zapsik and Ming Chen, which we've met Ming Chen before. But those two were the kindest.
They were so nice. And it was like, I don't know. You always feel like you won't get starstruck when you meet these people, but it's like, whoa, these are these people, like, you know. But they were just very down to earth. I feel like it would be hard to have that kind of fame and not let it go to your head, but for these guys it really didn't. They Mike Zapsik, you know, while we were filming, he was so sweet. He was asking me where I was from and if I was excited to be there, and just trying to, he's like, you know, calm down, it's all good, you just go and you be yourself. And I'm like, oh, thanks, because I'm like freaking out.
You should have been like, hey, how's it going? I'm Kelly from The Reasons I'm Broke. Yeah, I know, we're all superstars here. Let's just get this
done. Just come on, this is how much I want. You're not going to give it to me? Thanks.
We're getting this. This is a mutual beneficial thing, right? Yeah. Like, we're both gaining from this. Yeah. I know AMC and iTunes, right?
Same thing. We're just cross-promoting.
It's a crossover.
You guys are going to get, like, two more views from my endorsement here. I'm going to talk about this on my podcast.
Yeah, awesome, awesome, awesome experience. Unfortunately, you and Walter couldn't come up on a deal on the... Well, I'm not going to spoil that. Shit.
Now it's spoiled.
Or maybe they did. I don't know.
You'll have to watch and find out.
You go to amc.com and go to the Comic Book Men tab. Otherwise, you can head on over to iTunes and search in the iTunes store for Comic Book Men. It is Season 5, Episode 9, Suburban Cowboys. $2.99. It's right after the first commercial break. You see
about
Kelli
the
on there.
6-minute mark.
Yeah, definitely check it out. If not, I have been posting the link on our facebook.com/TheReasonsI'mBroke. Twitter, it is @ReasonsI'mBroke. But otherwise, again, check it out on iTunes. It'll always be there. I know it'll be on AMC for another 80 days, so you can check it out on there if you have a major cable service provider. But I know Netflix has been putting up seasons about a year after it airs. So if anything, if you're listening to this a year from now, you should probably be able to see this episode on Netflix. Again, Season 5, Episode 9.
Or if you're a robot in the future,
download this into your fucking head.
Yeah.
And watch Kelli try to sell Secret Wars number 8.
I do want to give a shout out, though. You know, through this whole experience, we had the opportunity to see friend of the show Tim Yates.
Yes.
And hang out with him for a while, and that was so cool. I'm so grateful that he took time out of his day to show us around his city, show us around, you know,
New Jersey.
Yeah, that was great. And then Thomas Mum as well. He's a great...
So gracious and
great
awesome.
Friend of the show, and he was awesome and coming and walking us through that process and being a part of that with us.
Believe it or not, the highlight was Tom Mum and Tim Yates. They were just the greatest. And again, like you said, they spent time from their busy day to hang out with us, which is never something you expect out of anyone. So to have that experience and to know that people legitimately care that you're there, and even if it's people that you already know and that you've met before, the fact that they still remember you as you were when you met them a year ago or so, and can still make such a pleasant experience for it and be excited that you're there for you, just to see you, not even the fact that you're going to be on Comic Book Men, but to show you around and give you the time of day and pay you so much attention in a busy schedule is amazing. So once again, big thanks to Tom Mum and Tim Yates. You are the greatest.
More people that are pretty great to the show also that we'll move into are our Patreon shout out of the week.
Big thanks this week to Lourdes and Katie. Thank you so much for your support on Patreon. It really helps our show continue and improve as we move forward and get more Patreon backers.
For as little as $1 a month, it averages out to about 25 cents an episode, unless we have those awesome months where you get 5 Sundays in there, and then it's even less, guys. You too could be a Patreon supporter.
Head on over to patreon.com/thereasonsimbroke, and you can see the various reward tiers. We have another one courtesy of decalavenue.net. If you donate $5 a month after 3 months, you will get an exclusive decal to the Reasons I'm Broke podcast. Really helps us out. Our next goal, aside from reaching our regular monthly cost, will be Alphonic Audio, which right now you are listening to an Alphonic Audio podcast.
Alphonic.
That would mean that we could get Alphonic Audio for all of our episodes, including our unboxings, including the Pokemon TCG Let's Play, but also we can start Skype interviews. We can start putting out interviews for the first guest, which I want to have Tim Yates on. Mm-hmm. If possible, we'd have Tom Mum, but also comic book writers out there, comic book creators, the first one being Tim Yates. We'd reach out to hopefully maybe, you know, Gail Simone or Jimmy Palmiotti, people we have had contact with in the past, or even local creators right here in Florida, just to mix it up a bit and have Skype interviews for broquettes out there, and hopefully to create a newer and deeper insight into the world of comics for our listeners.
Of course, though, guys, our show will always be free. We do this because we just like sharing our passion with you and hearing from you guys. So the best support you can ever give us is going onto iTunes and leaving a review or just communicating with us on Twitter at Reasons I'm Broke. Let us know what you thought of the show, things that made you broke this week, things you wish we would highlight on. If you're a Patreon supporter, we will definitely highlight those things. And if you're not, oops.
Yeah, huge thanks to everyone out there, our Patreon backers, our regular listeners out there. All of you, the fact that you're listening right now at this very moment is a big help to Kelli and I.
Especially 200 years in the future, robot friends. Thank you.
To 001001, thank you very much.
What?
That's a name of a robot out there.
How do you know? How do you know they don't just have, like, normal human names? Like Xenon.
That's a normal human name in the future.
And you didn't see Xenon Girl of the 21st century?
No, I don't know. That one went over my head.
And Protozoa?
Just like the
Zoom, 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 makes my heart go boom, boom, my supernova girl.
Zoom, 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 I'm gonna say ayo.
I don't know what you're singing. I am singing Protozoa. Oh my gosh, can I tell you about something really cool that happened tonight that I haven't even told you?
What's that?
So I went out to dinner with a friend, right? I went shopping all day, had to buy new clothes. And then we went out to dinner, and then we walked out of the restaurant, and my friend turns to me, like there was another like family with us, and she goes, do you know who that is? And I'm like, no, who is it? It was fucking Joey Fatone from whatever the hell he was in. Like, NSYNC or Backstreet Boys, whatever.
NSYNC.
Yes, NSYNC. He was right there.
The only reason I know this is because he is a big friend of the comic book men crew on that end with the Impractical Jokers mm-hmm. and all of them. And they always talk about Joey Fatone. And apparently he's been the one that has carried his career past everything else the most out of all of them, and he's right. Also the nicest, according to
him. Yeah, well, it was so weird because he was like right there and I knew who he was.
He lives in Florida.
Yeah, well, I mean, obviously, because he was at the restaurant.
Well, he could have been here just shopping around on a trip.
Why would he go to that place? Because, like, that's not really a tourist attraction.
That's cool, though, that you saw him on yeah. there. It just looked the same, I'm assuming, right?
Yeah, and I was like, oh, that's him. And, like, I kept walking. Like, I didn't want to, like, stare because he was with his kids or something.
Hey, how's it going? I was on AMC last week. Yeah, on The Walking Dead? No. Comic Book Man. It's much better. It is.
You should watch me. I'm on iTunes.
I've seen more episodes of Comic Book Man than I've seen Walking Dead.
This is true. Anyway, that's my story of the week. We can get into our comic book highlights.
Well, I have to address this Deadpool thing.
Okay, fine.
As I was talking about earlier.
Yes.
Went over my head.
Yes.
And I keep getting tweets about this, so yes. I have to address it.
Okay.
The end credit scene.
Yes.
Where I didn't understand why people found it funny that he was in a bathrobe.
Yes.
After the credits. It's apparently a reference to Ferris Bueller's Day Off, which I've never seen.
Never seen it.
Okay, so it went both over both of our heads.
I just thought he was in a nice bathrobe.
That's what I thought, too, and then that's why I didn't catch the joke, but apparently, yes.
I mean, I like bathrobes. I think they're comfortable, so I would assume that Deadpool, with his gross skin, would think they're comfortable, too.
I guess Ferris Bueller's Day Off is on Netflix now, It's okay. One of those that everyone else had seen around me in class, and I'd never seen, and I never heard of.
Like me with my Big Fat Greek Wedding?
Right. Actually, the second one comes out the same day as Batman v Superman.
Huh. Well, let's just go see that instead.
No, I don't really think so.
I think...
Is Wonder Woman in that Greek wedding?
She might be. You don't know. Maybe is that the Wonder tie-in? Wonder Woman's Big Fat Greek Wedding.
The tie-in movie to Batman v Superman.
The Big Fat Greek Wedding. No, that would be like my Big Fat Themyscira Wedding.
Oh, I'd watch that. I would watch that too. If that's a $1 million idea that someone like dorkily takes and makes a video out of, I'll be so mad.
Damn it. Cut that out of the podcast. Edit that shit out.
All right, on to our comic book highlights this week. Yes. We've got an indie book and a Marvel book.
Mm-hmm. First up, we have Mighty Morphin Power Rangers number 1. This is written by Kyle Higgins and Steve Orlando, with art by Hendry Prestia.
You can say that one. It's not that difficult.
Prestia?
Prasetya.
Wait, where'd you get the cha from?
Prasetya. Prasetya.
Okay. And Corin Howell.
Artist from Batmite.
Yep. And the colorist is Matt Herms and Jeremy Lawson.
In case you missed out on Mighty Morphin Power Rangers number 0, which is out of print, there's even a third printing, and even that one went out of print.
Shit.
You can pick up on number 1. I don't think you'd be lost at all. Number 0 was a good primer to the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers series, but number 1 still makes it clear that we're going to be following the most popular Power Rangers in the series, and that is Tommy, the Green Ranger.
Mm-hmm.
So all of this is him dealing with the fact that he's recently become good again after what we saw in the season. And even that one, they didn't explore it that much as far as he's struggling to not be under the control of Rita. So the fact that they explored this more in this tells me, one, that Kyle Higgins studied the show, went back and said that there's something missing here. And two, that Boom went, well, if we're going to put this comic out, we better go all out and not get canceled in the first year. So make it about Tommy. And it works.
One thing I really liked about this book is I felt that they did what the new Archie has done, where they really brought it forward into 2016. So a good portion of this book is spent with like a video podcast, so to say, where Bulk and Skull are going around interviewing people, asking them questions about the Power Rangers, and they tie in the Power Rangers themselves really well into that, which lends itself very well into the rest of the book. You know, we get to see a budding romance, and that's all I wanted to see. I'm like, screw all this other stuff. Like, go out for coffee already.
Oh, with the Pink Ranger and the Green? Yeah, which they did do in the series as well. Even the villain reveal at the end, I was like, oh, maybe she likes Tommy and the Green Ranger. Maybe there's something there.
Nope. There's not. My shipping powers have not sensed it, so it does not exist.
Your fanfic powers, you mean?
my awesome shipping powers.
What is that, shipping powers?
Shipping, like, I see who should be together. Like, my relationshipping
powers. Oh, ship. Okay, I got it now.
It's my shipping powers. Come on, Danny.
I almost felt like in the Bulk and Skull thing, they were making fun of video makers and podcasters. I'm like, oh, they're saying the things, like, they're the two idiots in the show, or in the show and the comic, and now they're like, hey, be sure to subscribe. I'm like, I say that. By the way, guys, make sure to subscribe to youtube.com/thereasonsimbroke. We're almost to 300 subscribers on there. Again, that's youtube.com/thereasonsimbroke.
I didn't feel like they were making fun of them. That's just realistic. That's what we do, obviously, because you just did it yourself.
Yeah, any chance you can get to plug in the shows, you do it, you take it.
Anyreasonsimbroke.com, chances that you can
reasonsimbroke.com. It's actually thereasonsimbroke.com.
Oh, I apologize.
I hope someone didn't buy reasonsimbroke.com and make it like something else that they're going to get hits on.
Porn.
Damn it. Thereasonsimbroke.com. Marvel book. We've got Spider-Man number 2, written by Brian Michael Bendis, who was in the InStore Convention Kick-Off, had about 40 minutes, did really good.
Awesome.
Talked about Civil War 2, which is going to be pretty exciting. We're going to pick that up because it's being written by Bendis. Art by Sarah Pacelli, colors by Justin Ponsor.
Really enjoying this direction that we're going with Miles. He, of course, survived. Who cares?
Ultimate End.
Who cares? He survived that, made it into this new universe where we get to see his mom is alive and Peter Parker's there too. Mm-hmm. And a lot of shit's going down, but we get to see him being awesome. And I like that they kind of pulled some political things, I felt, into this book as well.
Yes, in the which is still a topic of discussion, and that is in the way the interaction. I'm not going to say treatment because it's we don't have all the information all the time, but it is definitely the story, and that is the interaction between police and African American young males, and that's what we got out of this one. But also the political aspect of where does this character fit in into the main Marvel universe? It's obviously not going to be an easy fit. And also the fact that his mom is alive. Do you think that was a rewrite of sorts with Bendis in which he went, maybe I shouldn't have killed her off. We can still do more with her. Or is it more of, well, let's see how Miles appreciates the fact that he lives in this alternate universe in which he does have his mom again?
I feel it's more of the latter, where it's not... Stories also always have different paths that they can go down. And I don't think him killing her off was a regret that he had. But I think it's more of, we explored this world where, with Miles, where his mom did pass away. Let's see what the reverse would be like. Let's see how that character is going to evolve with this other influence in his life. I like the political aspects you brought up, but that wasn't even the one that I pulled most from this. And I don't think it's too much of a spoiler, but they discover that Miles is a Spider-Man of color
right
in this issue. And Miles brings up the great point that, you know, I don't want to be the first Spider-Man of color. I just want to be Spider-Man.
Right.
And I think that's a great message, you know, especially now, of course, we have the first African-American president or the, you know, and we shouldn't be talking about it that way. He's a president.
Sure.
You know, and things like that where we still, even though you're saying these things and not saying it, so much of being race is still a factor in it. And I think we as a nation, as a culture, need to move past that, and people are people.
I agree, but you should also, it's still important to recognize the fact that this diversity exists. And
of
that's,
course.
And it's a product of the time that we live in which we should recognize, and I understand your point in which, yes, it's just a Spider-Man, and yes, it's just another president, but... It's a milestone at the same time.
Milestone.
One thing that Bendis made a point of doing in this was that he said, I'm also Hispanic. And that was something that Miles was annoyed at. And he said, I'm not just Black Spider-Man. I'm also Hispanic. And Bendis even had this... took the time to introduce now the Hispanic side of his family for Miles, in which, like, the sassy, was it his grandmother?
Yeah.
He came in and said, oh, no, mijo, you're not going to do this. And I'm like, oh, shit, there it is.
Oh, shit, it's going down. He doesn't understand.
Like, now he's hitting the other side of that, that in which they have marketed that way. When I worked at the comic shop when we first had Miles Morales, and the main thing was, oh, it's a Black Spider-Man. And it's like, well, no, he's also half Puerto Rican. It's also a Latino Spider-Man. And that's something that they hadn't really focused on as far as the news goes and as far as the media. And even the comic itself, like, yeah, we know he's half Hispanic, but we're mainly seeing the interaction between him and his dad because of the natural fact that his Hispanic mom was dead. But now that she's alive again, now it seems like Bendis is saying, even he himself, it almost feels like he's annoyed by the fact that he said, look, I also made him half Latino for a reason.
Right.
And this is where we're going to see that. So me, as a Hispanic reader, appreciates that because I'm like, well, I don't have Blue Beetle right now. And that new Ghost Rider kind of sucked, so I've got Miles.
And Aquaman's not really.
Right, he's just brown like me and sort of looks like me. So so yeah, and I think that's smart of Bendis as far as storytelling goes.
It was a very good issue. I'm sure you guys can still find number one out there. Maybe somewhere
there's a second printing out that you can get.
Okay, perfect. So I would definitely recommend jumping on with number one, catching up with number two. So far, it's really good. Something we're enjoying a lot.
So those were our comic book highlights and the podcast for this week. We do want to remind everyone once again, if you haven't yet, go to amc.com, check out Kelly's appearance on Comic Book Men, season 5, episode 9. Huge highlight, and a huge thanks to all the Brookheads out there, especially. For getting us to this point, because if we hadn't been doing the podcast or the video reviews, maybe we wouldn't have reached out to try to do something like this. And that's all thanks to the support of all Brookheads out there. So it all goes back down to you, the listeners, the core of the show. Thank you so much, Brookheads.
As always, if you guys want to see everywhere you can find us, you can head over to thereasonsimbroke.com. It lists all the podcatchers where you can listen to us, our YouTube channel where we put up some unboxings this week as well.
That's right.
So you can check those out, subscribe, follow, leave us a review. Every little bit helps.
And if you do want to support us monetarily, you can head on over to patreon.com/thereasonsimbroke. Otherwise, leave us a review if you haven't yet on iTunes. We finally surpassed 20 reviews on there. And you can just search in the store, thereasonsimbroke.com. Even if you don't write us up a review, leave us 1 through 5 stars right there. And all of that helps us in the charts into reaching new brokettes.
And as always, if you guys listen to the show and there's things you like, things you didn't like, things you wanted to highlight more on, talk about more, you can head over to Twitter at ReasonsImBroke. Let us know what you thought. Let us know what you want to hear. We are here for you guys. This is a very listener-driven show. We are always open to suggestions.
I can't say it enough. Thank you so much for everything and for tuning in. I'm Daniel.
And I'm Kelli.
We'll see you next week.